Hi, this is Yaffi Lvova, registered dietitian nutritionist with Baby Bloom Nutrition, and welcome to Naptime Nutrition. Today, by special request, we will be talking about mental health and nutrition, specifically postpartum depression and postpartum anxiety, mainly because it's my scope to talk about this particular part of the life cycle, pregnancy through toddlerhood. So I won't really cover any other types of mental health outside of that narrow focus, but a lot of this information will be applicable to other types of depression and anxiety. I'm also going to preface this by saying that dealing with depression and anxiety is a team effort, and the information that I'm about to give does not override what your doctor or your therapist advises. It's meant to be in conjunction with therapies and medications that might come from other team members helping you through this very difficult part in life. So first I want to explain where I'm coming from with this and what my history is with this, because I think it's important to know. I had twins in 2013 after a long battle with infertility, and that put me at risk for having postpartum depression. Also, having twins alone put me at risk because there's a higher come down from those pregnancy hormones. I had more hormones than if you had had a single pregnancy. Different people have different risk factors, but there are different things that cause postpartum depression and postpartum anxiety. Not having enough support, not feeling that support, not feeling loved, not feeling appreciated. It can be very difficult to go from not being a mother to being a mother, or from being a mother of one to being a mother of two, or from being a mother of seven to being a mother of eight, for that matter. And it all comes with external and internal influences. You have those hormones that are going on from the pregnancy, but you also have the family drama and the lack of sleep and all of these other factors coming together in order to contribute to your awful mood. And a lot of people miss the diagnosis of postpartum depression or postpartum anxiety because they see what's on the news. They see, you know, awful, awful things that I don't even want to mention, and they think, well, that's not me, so I must be okay. But that's not how it is. There are plenty of people who are coping with postpartum depression and postpartum anxiety who are not on the news. It doesn't have to be that dramatic. And the truth is that the people who are making it to the news are likely suffering from postpartum psychosis as opposed to postpartum depression. It is related, but it really gives the rest of us more normal people the idea that this must be okay because I haven't tried to do something awful. And that's not really how it is. If you feel that you are depressed or you are anxious, if you have a boulder on your chest that you cannot get off no matter what you do, speak to your doctor because you deserve to feel better. This is supposed to be a beautiful time in your life, and if you can't appreciate it because of external influences that can be dealt with through therapy, or internal influences such as those hormones that can be dealt with through nutrition and exercise and sometimes, yes, medication, you really need to set yourself up for success. Set yourself up to love motherhood because you can do it. And if this is really resonating with you, please feel free to PM me for anything, really, but really talk to your doctor. I've been there. I know what it's like. It's awful. So let's talk about how you can deal with it from a nutrition perspective. And again, this is one slice of the pie, and pie is on my list. So let's see. First, speak to your doctor. What is postpartum depression and postpartum anxiety? Depressed mood, severe mood swings, recurrent thoughts of suicide, thoughts of harming yourself or your baby, severe anxiety, severe irritability and anger, fear of being alone with your child. And it doesn't mean that you're afraid that you're going to do something. It could just be, I am afraid of being alone in a room with my child with no backup. That could be the end of that fear, but it is an indicator. Difficulty bonding with your baby. Those are the more severe symptoms that would really tell me if you have any of those, please speak to your doctor right away. There are numbers you can call. I'm going to post an infographic that has an emergency number that you can call. And some of the more mild ones, fear that you're not a good mother, inability to sleep or sleeping too much, overwhelming fatigue or loss of energy, feelings of worthlessness, shame, guilt, inadequacy, diminished ability to think clearly or make decisions, excessive crying, loss of appetite, or very increased appetite. And that's, you know, if you're breastfeeding, you're going to have a massive increase in appetite. It's more taken in context of the rest of these symptoms. Withdrawing from friends and family, that's a really big one. If you are isolating, not because you're tired, but because you just feel like you need to be by yourself all the time, that's a trigger that you need to speak to someone. So what can you do? You hear about people talking about self-care all the time. So what does that mean? Well, the truth is it means something different for each person, and it could take you a while to figure out what it means for you. For some people, it's curling up with a good book. For some people, it's mani-pedis. For some people, it's going out for a drink with friends. Or for some people, it's just alone time to recharge. If you have you're alone and you recharge. It's okay to do that. It's just more if you're isolating on a regular basis, that's something to consider. Eat something. Really. We spend so much time taking care of those around us that we forget to take care of ourselves. So eat something. Make some snack stations around your house like you have a diaper station so that there's a visual cue. I should eat something now. I should drink some water. And I'll get more into that also. Take a shower and get dressed. Hanging around in your pajamas all day is fun in the beginning. It's not fun after a while. You can put the baby in a bouncy seat to take a shower. You can. With some babies, they have the temperament. They want to go in the shower with you. And that's fine. You'll feel better. Take an Epsom salt bath to relax. That your body will absorb the magnesium from the Epsom salt and it helps your muscles to relax, which can help your brain to relax. Play some great music. I've been working on a Spotify list for the past couple of years with just all the songs that I have always played on repeat, the songs that I've always loved. And that's just my chill out mix. And that's a great thing to do. It just makes you feel a lot better. Move your body in a way that makes you happy. Joyful movement. Next week, I'm going to have a guest on, Sarah Kupfer, who's a personal trainer. And we're going to be talking about joyful movement. And what it means, connect with a friend on the phone or in person, not on Facebook. It doesn't count. It doesn't give you that connection to connect with people on social media. It just doesn't do the same thing. So as far as actual nutrition, hydrate. If you're breastfeeding, you need up to 13 cups of water per day. And there are a lot of factors. I did a Naptime Nutrition specifically on hydration, and you can go back and check that out. But you really want to make sure you're drinking enough. And the number one way to see if you're drinking enough is the color of your urine. You really want that light yellow color. That's going to indicate that you have enough hydration. Set up snack stations that I mentioned. Some good things to include are lactation cookies, nuts, anything that is shelf stable that can stay out. Granola bars, applesauce packets, even those baby food puree packets that I did a Naptime Nutrition against. Well, in this situation, it's something shelf stable that'll give you some good energy. So it's a good thing to have just to knock back when you really haven't eaten. Consider meal planning to ensure proper balance. And I'm running a meal planning boot camp that's going to be starting soon, so let me know if you're interested in that. Stock and prepare foods that you can grab easily. And I'm going to post also a list of foods that you can easily semi-prep that you can just have ready to grab and make into something else or eat as they are. Focus on whole foods in your diet. Beans, peas, seeds, nuts, and fish should be in your regular rotation. Do not focus on weight loss right now. Focus on happiness and health and treating your body like it belongs to someone you love. A high fiber eating plan can help you with quality of sleep. And when you're not getting a lot of sleep, it's best to maximize the quality. And fiber is in lots of vegetables, so eat lots of vegetables. Focus on adequate and balanced eating to feel your best. It's really fun, you know, just grab a Snickers bar. Great. And I'm not against that because, well, Snickers. But you really want to make sure that you balance that out to make sure that you're taking care of yourself so you can feel your best. As far as supplementation, you're going to want to run this by your doctor to make sure it doesn't interfere with anything else you might be taking. But probiotic, vitamin D, a lot of people are deficient. I did last week's Naptime Nutrition on vitamin D supplementation. How do you know what you should take? So go check that out. Take a multivitamin. Continue with your prenatal or your postnatal in order to get the nutrition that you need. Omega-3s, I love a good fish oil. B-complex, folate, not folic acid. And you can look back to my MTHFR gene mutation, naptime nutrition, to see more about that and why you should probably be on folate instead of folic acid. Zinc and selenium are great things to have for helping with mood control, and those are found in a lot of different nuts and seeds. Also, talk to your doctor about checking your iron status, your vitamin D status. Check your thyroid function, because even if you don't have a history of your thyroid going out of whack, a lot of times pregnancy can really affect that. And it can affect your mood, it can affect your weight, it can affect a lot of things. And the MTHFR gene mutation, which I mentioned, and I have a naptime nutrition on that already, so go check that out. If you are feeling anxious or you're feeling depressed and you've had a baby a month ago or 4 months ago or 6 months ago or 2 years ago, talk to someone. And if no one's taking you seriously, talk to someone else, because if you think that you could feel better and that you would be a better mother if you could feel better, find someone who will listen, and I'm here. And if you have any comments or questions, please comment below. And I have not picked a topic for next week. Oh no, I have. I have. Sarah Kupfer is coming on with me to talk about happy movement and how it can contribute to your happy mood. And with that, I'm going to go do my happy movement. And I hope to hear from you. So see you next week. Thanks.